This is Rahul Malhotra from SFDC Stop, and welcome to the seventh tutorial in the Salesforce Integration tutorial series. So in this tutorial, we are going to create a test class for an Apex web service. So if you remember, in the previous tutorial, we actually created different methods to cover different HTTP, different Apex methods to cover different HTTP methods like get, post, delete, put, and patch. So we created all these methods like a get method, a post method, put method, patch method, and delete method. We covered all the HTTP methods in our custom API. So now what I have done, I have actually updated my contact resource class with all the methods, with the get annotation as well as with the post annotation, with you can say delete annotation, with put annotation, as well as with patch annotation. So I have covered all the five methods here that we have in Salesforce, and I have combined them together in my contact resource class. So our task for this tutorial is to create a test class for our contact resource class, which is nothing but a custom API made in Apex, right? So if you remember, there were different scenarios. Like in get method, I was actually giving the contact limit in the URL, and I was querying the contact. So if you have watched my previous tutorials, you must be aware of this. In case of post method, I was giving the contact details and I was creating a new contact and returning it in the response. In my delete method, I was actually getting the ID of the contact that I want to delete from the URL, and I was deleting that contact and returning a response. In my put method, I was actually, getting the ID, and put is used for upsert. So if my ID is there, then I was creating, then I was actually updating that contact. Otherwise, I was creating a new contact using the upsert operation. In case of HTTP patch, what I was doing, I was actually updating a contact whose ID I got in the URL itself. So I'm going to create a test class for this whole class, but we are going to see a few methods in our test class, because it's a quite long test class that I have. However, you can have a look at the code and you can tell me if you are not able to understand any of the methods in my test class. But I'll cover all the necessary scenarios, and the rest of the methods are same in the test class, right? So just want to share some basics of the test class. Like whenever you are creating a test class, you must have @ is test annotation with the test class itself, as well as with each of the test method that you are creating. So you should have @ is test annotation. You can also use a keyword which is known as test method here, but I personally like is test annotation, because it's similar for class as well as the methods that we have. So you can use the @ is test annotation to tell Salesforce that this is a test method and this is a test class. So Salesforce will not require coverage for this test class, because it is actually a test class which is used to cover other Apex classes. So whenever we create a test class, we need some kind of test data, right? Because in case of test class, we are not actually inserting, or you can say committing, our data in Salesforce. We are creating dummy data. So that dummy data can be created using a single method. We can specify a separate method in which we are just creating our test data, and we can specify that method using the test setup annotation. So this test setup annotation will actually tell Salesforce whenever this test class is running. So it will tell Salesforce that Salesforce, this is the test method that this is the test data that you have to create first of all before executing any of the test method. So it will create all the data which is being created in the test setup annotation method, and then it will execute all the test methods. So this method is executed first of all in every test class, which is with test setup annotation, and then the rest of the methods are executed, right? So let's move on and let's see our first method, which is the test get contact ID and names method, how it's working, right? So this method is actually testing our get contact ID and names method. So if you remember, in this method, what I was doing, I was actually getting the list of I was doing nothing. I'm just giving the contact limit in the request, and I'm returning a list of contacts in the response. So let me quickly save this contact resource class. I think it's already saved. So let me show you so that you don't forget what it was doing actually. So whenever I do a get request along with the number, let's say I want to query four contacts to my contact API. Okay, so session is timed out. Let me log in again. Okay, so we are in. What we need to do, we need to use our contact API and I need to give some number, let's say 4. So what it will do, it will actually query 4 contacts from my org and it is showing me the response. So this was what our get API is doing. It was querying the ID and name of the number of contacts that I want to query and it was giving me the response. If I say 6 here, it is querying 6 contacts from my org. So I mean, we have already covered it in the previous tutorial. So now we'll focus on test class. So this method is doing nothing. It is getting the request. It is getting the number of contacts that I want to query. It is actually applying a limit and querying the ID and name of each contact. And it is finally returning a list of contact in the response. So in case in the test class, what I have to do, I actually have to create a dummy request. So I use the test request class to create a request. And I have specified a request URI, which is similar to my actual URL. So my actual URL is my Salesforce instance, then services, then Apex REST. So it is services, Apex REST, and then I have contact API / the number of contacts that I want to query. So I have specified it as contact API and then 1. So I have specified 1 there because I want to query only 1 contact in my dummy request that I'm creating. And I also have only 1 contact in my org right now because that is the test data that I have created. So I'm querying only 1 contact here. I have specified the HTTP method as get so that my actual call will automatically call only the get method. And I have actually set the request in the restContext.request. So restContext.request is used to actually set the actual REST request. So my actual REST request is now set using the contact request that I have created. So this is doing nothing. This is actually creating a dummy request and it is setting the actual you can say request, HTTP request, with the dummy request that I have just created. So finally, what I did, I actually called my get contact ID and names method from my contact resource class, which is there. So in case of contact resource class, I actually called my get contact ID and names method. And then I added some asserts, like it is checking if my return context is not equal to null. It is also checking that my return context should have a size of 1 because I have specified 1 here. And it is actually checking that my return context name is equal to Richard Hendricks. So this is the name that I specified as the first name and last name of my contact when I was inserting a contact. So I'm just checking that my return context should have the same name, which I set. I have set during you can say calling the API. So here you can see that I'm just checking a search for that my return contact list should not be null because this method is actually returning a list of contact to me which was given in the response. So I'm checking that this list should not be null. Second thing, I'm checking that this list should have a size of 1 because this is the size that I have given in the request. And finally, I'm checking that my return contact have the correct information because this is the contact that is present in my org and it should be returned when I'm querying, I mean when I'm calling this API, right? And I have used test.starttest and test.stopTest method, which specify Salesforce that this is when the test is starting and this is when the test is I'm stopping the test. So we should use test.starttest and test.stopTest in each test method that we create. Okay, so I mean you can change this stuff. You don't have to use actually AP5 or your actual Salesforce instance URL, but at the end of the URL it should end exactly the same as we are creating an actual request. I mean, why this is required? Because I am actually getting the contact limit using the contact request URI here, so the URI should be correct. So it's good if you can use you can create a environment that is similar to the or you can say a replica of the actual environment that you have whenever you are creating a request. So this method is successfully covering the test, the get contact ID and names method. So this is how we are actually covering this method, and we are actually checking that the list of contacts should be same that we have created. So let's move on to another method that we can check right now. So we actually tested a method that is using the URI and getting the information from the URI. So for that, what things we need to take care of? We need to take care of 1 or 2 things. The first of all, that we are actually creating a URI and or you can say dummy request, and we are actually setting that dummy request, because even if we haven't set this dummy request, we will not be able to do this stuff and get the contact limit from the URL, because I haven't set a dummy request right now. So it's important to set a dummy request if we are dealing with the URL parameters or the body or something like that. So that's why I created a dummy request and set it here. And finally, I mean, the asserts are doing nothing. Asserts are simply checking if the response is correct or not. So I can either use system.assert that should have a boolean value, and I can either use system.assert equals that compare two values whether they are equal or not. So let's move on to another method. So we'll now move on to test create new contact method. So in case of test create new contact method, if you remember in our context resource class, create new contact method was doing nothing. It was creating a new contact with the information that I have given. So my information should be first name, last name, birth date, and lead source, and it will create a new contact and it will return that contact in the response. So this is the code for that. Let me check it very quickly. So I will create a JSON body here. I will specify some of the things like the first name. Let's say it's Gavin, and let's say the last name, and let's say it's Belson, and let's say the birth date here. I think we can skip the birth date because it will it may show error in the date format because I don't remember that right now. So I'm skipping the birth date, and I'm specifying the lead source because I know that the lead source have is option of web. So I'm going to make a post request right now real quick. So the URL doesn't matter because we are don't using that, and it is giving me an error that an argument cannot be null. So I have to specify a date here. Let's say the birth date is actually, yeah, I'm using date.parse method here. That's why it's showing me an error that an argument cannot be null. So the birth date, let's say it's 1978-02-25. I hope it will work. Let's give it another try. And our date format is not correct. Let's change it to this thing. I think it should work. Okay, so this is also an invalid. Okay, so I changed the date format to the correct one that we were using. I mean, I have already specified how this date format is working in the previous tutorial because I'm using the date.parse method. So it actually parses the date that is in this format, which is the day here and the month here and the year here. So I corrected the birth date and I clicked on execute, and I'm finally getting that a contact is created which is returned in the response, and the contact ID is this. So I can quickly check this ID to see if my contact is created or not. And I can see here that my Gavin Belson contact is created with the name, birth date, and lead source, right? So, I mean, this method is very simple. Simple as doing nothing. It is getting the input from the parameters of the method, I should say. And it is actually inserting a contact and returning a contact in the response. So remember, in the previous method, we actually got an input from the URL. Here we are getting the input from the method variable. So you can say the attributes, and in the next method, we'll do something else. So let's move on to our test class and see how it is working. So in this case, what I did, I don't have to, create a dummy request. Even I can test this method without creating a dummy request because I'm not actually using the request here. I'm doing nothing with the request body. I mean, I'm using the request body, but that request body is actually automatically mapped to the parameters, right? So I'm not actually accessing the request body inside my method, so I don't need to create a dummy request. So that's why what I did here, I actually used the test.startTest, test.stopTest to start and stop the test. And in between, I simply called my method with the required input. That is the first name, the last name, the date of birth, and then the lead source, which is the web. And finally, what I did, I checked that my return contact is not equal to null. I also checked that my return contact ID is not equal to null. And finally, I queried that contact which was recently created, because now my test data will have two contacts because I just created another contact here using my API. And I confirmed that my queried contact with this particular ID that was returned in the response is not equal to null. And I checked that the lead source of my return contact should be equal to the lead source of the queried contact. That is, the contact which was returned by the API, its lead source should be equal to the contact that is there in the system, which is the queried contact. So return contact here is the contact that was returned from my API, and queried contact is the contact that is actually created in the system. So I'm checking both the lead sources to just verify that my API is working perfectly and it is returning the same contact that is created in Salesforce in the response. So, you know, in case you are dealing with request URL or request body, then only you have to focus on creating a dummy request and setting that request using REST context.request. Otherwise, if you're not doing any kind of stuff and if you're simply using the method parameters and giving the input in the parameters, you don't need to do anything. You just need to call that method and you need to check that whatever functionality your method was performing, that's actually there in Salesforce. Okay, so we can move on to another method now. I am going to just take one more method, which is, let's say, test update contact, because it is actually using a different kind of approach. So test update contact method, I think it's actually used for the patch operation. So yeah, test update contact method is actually calling the update contact method of my contact resource class. So if I go to my update contact method, it is called when a patch operation is performed. So a patch operation did nothing, but it actually updates my contact here. So let's perform a patch operation and let's see how it's working. So in case of patch operation, what I have to do, I actually have to give a contact ID in my URL, like I'm specifying here, and I have to do some kind of update. Let's say my lead source was initially web, so I'm updating my lead source for this particular contact to, let's say, phone inquiry, right? So when I execute this API, it will actually update my lead source from web to phone inquiry. Right now it's web, you can see here. So let's click on execute and let's see if it works perfectly or not. So here I can see in the response that my contact ID is given. Actually, not only contact ID, it's actually the contact object that is returned in the response, because it has a type of contact and the ID and the lead source. And it is showing me that the lead source is updated to phone inquiry. So I can go to my org and I can refresh this page to see if my lead source is updated to phone inquiry or not. So my lead source is automatically updated here when I executed the API. So our task here now is to create the test class for this method. Here I am again getting the input, you can say. It's a different kind of method, because here I'm getting partial input, that is my contact ID, through my URL, and I'm getting partial input through my request body also, because this is the lead source that I have to update, right? So I'm getting the input from the request body as well as I'm getting the input from the request URL, and I'm performing some kind of operation in which I'm updating a contact and I'm finally returning a contact in the response. So what I have to do here, I have to again create a dummy contact and I have to see whether it works or not. So what I did, first of all, in this test method, I'm again using the test.startTest and test.stopTest methods to specify when the test is started and stopped. And first of all, I'm getting the contact which is going to be updated, right? Because I need to specify I need to get this contact ID, which I need to send in the request, right? So I got the ID of the contact because I have to specify this ID at the end of the URL from where my API will fetch it. And I am actually specifying, form the request body also. So let's do it one by one. Let's see first of all what we are doing. We actually created a dummy request using my REST request class. I actually set the request URI to my Salesforce instance, test services, then Apex Test, then contact API, and then the ID of the contact which I'm going to update. So that's why I queried this contact before, because I had to give the ID of the contact at the end. So if you remember, in my test data, I created one contact. So one contact is already there in my org. So I queried that contact and I actually set that contact ID at the end of my URL so that my API can work by having it, right? I set the HTTP method to patch so that my patch method will be called, and I set the dummy request body to the value of which is json.serialize.context. So this is the thing that we have to understand right now. What I'm doing here is that I created a new contact object, and I set the first name as Gavin here. And if you remember, in my test class, when I inserted a test method, test data, in that case, the contact has a name of Richard Hendricks. So what I'm going to do as an update, I'm actually updating my Richard Hendricks contact with the first name as Gavin. So my contact name will now be updated to Gavin Hendricks. So for to specify an update call, I should say, I have actually specified the ID of the contact at the end of the URL. And I created a contact because I am actually giving my contact details in the request body. And this is nothing but the API name, and this is the value. So what I did, I simply created a contact, and I converted this contact object into JSON using JSON.CLIs method. So what this will do, it will actually convert a contact object into JSON. So I mean, whatever fields I have specified here, like let's say I have specified here first name as Gavin, so it will create a JSON like this, where I will have the first name and its value will be Gavin. So I mean, you can use a system.debug to check these things. However, I'm telling you that it will convert a contact object into a JSON serialized string. So that string will be something like this, where I have the first name, because the first name field I have specified here, and it will have a value Gavin. Let's say if I have the last name also along with the first name. So if I specify the last name also here, let's say last name. So in that case, I mean, just make it capital. So in this case, when I have specified the last name here, because this is the API name of the field, so it should be correct. And I have given it some value, let's say something else. So it will have another input in the JSON with the value of last name and with the value as whatever I did there. Okay, so it will create a request body, which is a JSON request body, which I got by serializing the contact object that I created above. Okay, so once I have the contact object, what I'm doing, I'm actually converting it into a blob, because my contact request, which I'm creating, I mean my dummy contact request, can only accept the request body in the form of a blob. So you can see here that my REST request class has a request body variable, which is of type blob. So I can only set blob content in this request body variable. So to convert my string into blob, I'm using blob.valueOf method, which takes a string argument and returns a blob in the response. So first of all, I converted my contact object into a JSON string, and then I converted this JSON string into a blob, and I set that blob into my request body. Okay, so even if you remember, whenever we take a request body, we actually convert this request body into a string using the toString method. Why? Because this is actually a blob, and my toString method converts a blob into a string, because I need my request body in the string here. So here I'm converting a string into a blob so that my request body is set perfectly. And finally, I use the rest context.requests to set my input request. So my input request is up and running and ready now, because here I have specified the contact ID, and here I have specified whatever I have to update. Okay, so what I did, I actually simply called a method, that is my contact request.update contact. So this is the same method which was called whenever a patch request is actually performed. So whenever a patch request is performed, it will call this update contact method. So I called this update contact method, and the contact which was returned in the response to us is actually stored in a variable named as return contact. And finally, what I did, I actually queried my contact again using the ID that I specified, and I'm checking whether my return contact ID, that is the contact which is given to me in the response, is the same is of the same ID that I give in the input, or you can say that the ID that was given in the input. So my queried contact ID is nothing but the ID of the contact which is updated in the system, and my return contact is the contact which is returned by the API. So my return, I'm just checking if the return contact is the same that was updated in the system. And finally, I'm checking that my first name should now be changed to Gavin from Richard, and my last name should be the same, which is Hendricks. So if this information is correct, that means my Richard Hendricks contact, which was created using the test method, is now updated with the first name as Gavin and the last name as Hendricks. So now I should have my contact information as Gavin Hendricks in the system. So I mean, all the update is done by the actual method, but what we need to take care of, we need to take care of two things. First of all, that we actually set the dummy request if required properly. Even if the if there is a URL and if there is a request body, we should you know, set it properly. And finally, we should have at least one or two asserts in our test method so that we can check whether the return contact is the same which is actually updated, and I can check that my contact is actually updated in my org. So this is what I am checking here. The rest of the contacts that we have, I mean, rest of the methods that I have here is the same thing. So I mean, I actually, you know, showed you three different ways. In the first test method, we were doing nothing. We were actually setting a dummy request, and we were only setting the URL for that dummy request here, right? In the second method, what we did, we haven't set a dummy request because in this case, all my information is automatically mapped to the method parameters. And in case of the third scenario, we set a dummy request as well as we set the request body of my dummy request, and I actually called that method so that it can get the dummy request automatically using the rest context.request that I have set for my test method, and it can perform the operation. It can return me the response. So this is how, I mean, my test class is made. I have a few more methods. If you go to my GitHub repository and you can check the test classes here in the rest callout test branch. So you can see here that I have created test class named as contact resource test. So here I have all the code, and I have actually created methods that is covering the whole class. And you can directly, you know, use this test class, and you can see that it will show you 100% coverage for all the methods, and you can have a look how each method is covered. However, I have specified you three different scenarios here that was most important, that how I should set a dummy request in case of a request body, in case there is no request body, there is only a URL change, or in case there is nothing at all. So these were the three main methods that I had to cover while creating a test class tutorial. So that's all for this tutorial, everyone. If you like this, just let me know your feedback in the comments down below, and you can have a look at my GitHub repository for all the code, and see you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye bye.